Do you remember the first game you ever owned? Or maybe a more interesting question is, do you remember the first game that made you fall in love with video games? I think everyone has that one game that started it all, a nostalgic classic that impacted their life at just the right time. Or maybe just a game that cheered you up when you needed it most, something that inspired you and gave you something to anticipate on your way back from school. Something you made embarrassingly bad fan art for when you were supposed to be taking notes in class. A game that defined your childhood. For me, that game was Spyro the Dragon on PlayStation 1, the first game on the first home console I ever owned. I had played a bunch of point-and-click games before and had some vague memories of watching someone play Donkey Kong Country when I was a toddler. That might have just been a fever dream, honestly. But Spyro was different. It was like this massive, interactive world that I could dive into and completely immerse myself in. A vivid virtual reality simulation, indistinguishable from real life. Okay, it looks like crap today, but at the time, this game was drop-dead gorgeous to me, and I just couldn't get enough of it. It's the first game I speed ran as a kid. I beat it like 20 times. I would constantly beat it in a single day, and I still replay it from time to time, even now. And due to a ridiculously generous fan, I recently came in possession of the Spyro Reignited trilogy, and also the Crash trilogy. Seriously, dude, thank you so much. You're amazing. This show is only possible because people donate to the Patreon and donate games to me, so thanks. You're cool. Anyway, now that I have access to the remake, I thought it would be a good time to finally chronicle my experience with the little purple punk himself. I'm going to focus exclusively on the first game this time around, and I'm going to be using some footage from both versions to compare and contrast them a little bit. But I will be focusing mostly on the remake. Also, this is gonna be another two-part review because I ended up writing a 20-page script about this thing. I just don't know when to shut up, I guess. Some things never change. Let's see if my old favorite still holds up after all these years. Spyro is a 3D platformer that originally debuted on the original PlayStation in 1997. That was 20 years ago. I could feel myself turning into dust. Anyway, it was a smash hit, and although his games varied wildly in quality after his original few games, the first three are perfect, timeless classics with absolutely no flaws whatsoever. The PS1 release is ultimately the one that's surgically attached to the centermost part of my heart, and you might think that would lead to me being biased. And you're right, I am. I still like this version a lot. But if I take off my rose-colored glasses for even a millisecond, it becomes undeniable. This remake is gorgeous. The Reignited trilogy has some of the most polished cartoony visuals I've ever seen in a video game. It's comparable to Luigi's Mansion 3. And if you saw my review on that game, you know I don't say that lightly. I'm so glad they kept the series as far away from realism as possible, but didn't abandon that surreal, kinda creepy appearance that so many of the enemies and locations have. I never thought they could make this monster even more nightmarish to me, but I mean, fuck. The colors are always perfectly balanced, with slightly exaggerated shading and lighting effects to really make the environment pop. I would recommend turning down some of the bloom effects on PC as well as the motion blur, but otherwise it's visually stunning. But this brain-melting graphical fidelity doesn't come cheap, and some of you probably have already noticed what I'm referring to just from the footage. This game stutters in every version you can own. We're not talking about apocalyptic stuttering. It's not like Sonic Boom or running Far Cry on your mom's toaster oven levels of bad, but it's noticeable. As far as I can tell, the game makes very little use of culling or simplifying graphics that are in the distance. This results in occasional bits of choppiness on the PS4 version, and my PC version as well, even with a modern PC, even with the settings not turned all the way up. My computer is less than 3 years old, by the way. I'm sure it's not going to bother everyone, and it certainly wasn't a deal breaker for me, but it definitely happened enough that it was worth bringing up in the review. But on the positive end of the graphics, I love what they did with the dragons in this game. They all have incredibly unique designs that actually reflect their jobs and specialties, as well as the culture of their native worlds. Compared to the original, where they were the same seven or so naked dragons repeated until the end of time, with slight color variations. I feel like the dialogue on the freed dragons can get a little redundant. Like, there has to be at least 15 dragons that tell you to use fire on big enemies and charge enemies with metal armor. Like, dude, I appreciate the advice, but this is like the seventh level. I don't even think I can get here without knowing the advanced tactics of pressing circle when I see a fat person. It's hardwired into my mind. My thumb twitches every time I look in the mirror. I do enjoy the aggressively 90s personality of Spyro, though. I think his new voice honestly suits him a little bit better, because in the original he was just kind of a little whiny, nasally brat.
What about Nasty Nork? I'm going after him.
Where's Nasty Nork? I'm going after.
Compare that to the new voice.
What about Nasty Nork? I'm going after him. Don't worry, I'll take care of them.
He's basically a wisecracking, kind of childish Saturday morning cartoon protagonist. We had a lot of those in the 90s. I'm glad that, for the most part, the remake didn't alter the tone of the game. The dialogue was all re-recorded, but they kept all the lines the same for the most part. This game acknowledges that the writing is a product of its time, and that's part of the charm. If you're going to play the Spyro trilogy, and you don't have any nostalgic attachment to the original, I would overall recommend the remake. It's incredibly polished, and was made with a clear passion and love for the original. With the old-school 32-bit graphics, you kinda had to fill in the blanks with your mind, add more detail in your own imagination, ignore the fact that half the dragons look the same, and translate this green JPEG as a verdant field of grass. But what's magical about the remake is that it manages to capture images similar to what I dreamt up in my head, in my own imagination, and render them in glorious 3D polygons. It is nothing short of awe-inspiring what this team managed to do with this remake. It is a beautiful game, and it managed to capture my imagination in a whole new way. The environments have an almost absurd level of detail, like this wooden chandelier in a swamp hut. You have to pan the camera straight up to even see this thing, and most players have definitely never noticed it, but they still took the time to model this asset and put it there. That is some serious dedication to your world design. Oh God! And yet, I still feel the original graphics tugging at me in a way that the new one doesn't. Nostalgia is a weird thing to think about, but Spyro was a huge part of my childhood. It was a huge part of my development as a person. I feel like I learned about 3D space and learned about technology and graphics and art through playing this game. I have a fully rendered 3D map in my head of every level from the original PlayStation. I vividly remember basking in the glow of an oversized CRT late at night with the lights off, with no sound except the sound of the game, crickets outside, and my dog snoring at my feet. He was a good boy. Spyro was a world I became obsessed with. It inspired me as a creator and just as a kid who was going through kind of a difficult time. It was a delight, and I'm glad that the remake can introduce this delight to a whole new generation. But since the original was such an instrumental part of my childhood, I still get tempted to pop in the original PlayStation game and stretch out my imagination once more. Yeah, you have to fill in the blanks with your own mind, but sometimes that's kind of part of the charm. It might look like a bunch of pixelated low-resolution vomit, but it's pixelated low-resolution vomit I have a lot of affection for. Nostalgia's a hell of a drug. But what I really love is the level design. that's where the magic is. This game has some of my favorite worlds in a 3D platformer. There's such an incredible level of openness and freedom to the game, and this largely revolves around the glide mechanic. It allows the game to fully utilize the verticality of each environment to its fullest. Once you start gliding, you can't go up any higher, but you can go for an extremely long time horizontally, while slowly descending. You'll be wandering around looking for a secret passage to get somewhere, and then you realize some kind of crazy gliding maneuver that the game genuinely expects you to pull off. And when you do pull it off, you feel like a badass, because it's not particularly easy. Figuring this stuff out for yourself is half the fun, and I'm amazed that I haven't seen a lot of games take advantage of this sort of movement. It encourages the player to meticulously scout out each area for the highest point and memorize level geometry so you can remember the exact moment when you have to curve around a blind corner or avoid an obstacle. In a game with lesser visuals, it would have been hard to memorize where you need to turn in midair, because again, for some of these glides, you can't see your final destination until you're really close to landing on it. But thanks to the clearly defined level geometry and some easily identifiable landmarks, it's simple to remember where you are in relation to that ledge on the other side of the wall, even when you can't see it. Even in the original, each area in each level stands out, and they all convey a different mood and contribute to the world building of that area. For one level, you'll start deep in the bottom of a river basin, dotted with pockets of toxic sludge. You'll work your way to a fortress that's built into the side of the cliff, discover a tunnel filled with gems and hostile enemies. Then you'll climb another fortress overlooking a huge, abyssal drop on the cliffside, and then plunder that fortress's riches. Then you'll glide to a rock formation and wind up directly above where you started the level, all in a smooth loop without even realizing that you were traveling in a circle. And that's just one of the routes you can take. There's a shorter way to complete the level, and a lot of optional vertical areas to explore. Most of the levels are designed in a way kind of similar to this. Spyro levels are like a medium between Super Mario Galaxy's linear but extremely polished platforming gauntlets, and the open-ended structure of something like Mario 64, which revolves more around exploration and completing a handful of miscellaneous tasks. You always have a decent sense of where the game wants you to go for the main objective, but there's often a multitude of ways to get there, and there's always a plethora of entirely optional areas in each place you visit. When I was a kid, gliding was actually pretty hard for me, mainly because my depth perception was kind of shit. But once I started getting the hang of it and managed to glide all the way to this cliff covered in vulture enemies, it blew my little prepubescent mind. Getting up to the top of the cliff and realizing I could get to those rooftops I saw before? Magical. And finding out that I could glide behind the fortress and find a secret treasure trove behind the place where I started the level? Just amazing. A discovery I made myself, just because I had gotten good enough at the game's movement and I was curious about the other side of the river. If you like exploring beautiful environments and having your curiosity constantly be rewarded, you are going to love this game. Spyro the Dragon is thoroughly dedicated to pulling you into its dreamlike realms, and because of that, the HUD is typically pretty minimal. Instead of a traditional health bar, your health is indicated entirely by Sparks, an in-game character that follows Spyro around. He's canonically a dragonfly, though in the original he looks more like a stick with some eyes glued to it, and in the remake, he looks like the demon I see during sleep paralysis. As you take damage, Sparks goes from gold to blue to green to an unseen corpse. And when he's not around, Spyro has to manually collect gems himself.
The horror.
Seriously though, I love this approach to displaying health. It's a simple thing, but it conveys the information to the player without forcing them to quickly look away from the center of the screen where the action is. I like that. The game also does a nice job of using glittering visual effects to highlight where distant gems are, which does a good job of drawing your eyes towards those secret destinations. That was like 15 minutes of talking, and I feel like I've barely gotten started with this game. I haven't even touched on the music, the enemies, the amazing flying minigame, and the fact that all the bosses completely suck ass. I had to split this video into two parts, partially because it was getting really long, and partially because this has just been a really shitty month, okay? But if you want to hear my expanded thoughts on the game, let me know what you want me to discuss in part 2 down in the comments. I should be able to put together a whole other video with how much I have to say about this nostalgic classic. Let's just say that the original script was a lot longer than this. Overall, I'd recommend the first Spyro to just about anyone. Its main campaign is pretty accessible. It's not too difficult. Most of the real ball-bursting stuff is thankfully optional. I'll talk more about that if I do a sequel to this video. So, if you're looking for a gorgeous game that rewards a curious player, you can't go wrong with Spyro the Dragon. You should probably get the remake, though. The original kind of looks poopy. But you know what isn't poopy? My patrons who keep the show running. There's unfortunately been a recent string of declined or glitched pledges on Patreon lately, and it is unfortunately affecting me and the show, so any new supporters would be extra appreciated. You even get to see episodes a day early sometimes, just for giving a single buck per video. As always, thank you so much for watching. You've all made this an incredible first year in my new location. This is obviously the most productive year the show has ever had. I got 2 videos out almost every month, with a few exceptions due to personal emergencies or just stuff with the family, etc. So, thanks to everyone who's been sharing, liking, and commenting. It's always super helpful for the algorithm. I hope you have a wonderful day, a great new year, and I hope you give your dog a big hug for me. They deserve it. How the fuck did I get 2 videos done in 4 days?